Proxmox in their PVE test release has just added support for VirtioFS within the GUI. And in this video, I'm going to take a look at how they implemented VirtioFS, what the performance and CPU usage is like, and how it compares to other methods like Samba, how VirtioFS can be used and what it generally is good for, and just kind of go over my thoughts of when it might make sense to use VirtioFS and when it might not be the best decision to use. So VirtioFS is a tool that's been part of the VirtIO set of tools and kind of part of the QEMU KVM umbrella of tools that the Linux and other open source maintainers have been going on for a bit with, and has been available to use in things like Virt Manager for a bit now. VirtioFS allows you to have a folder on the host OS, so in this case Proxmox, that is mapped to a mount point within a guest, either Linux or Windows from what I can see now. And then when it's mapped at a file level. So that means you can actually have multiple guests having that same folder mapped at the same time on them, and you can also have that host add files and then pull it out from the guest. Think of it kind of like a network share, but instead of being done over like a virtual network connection or a real network connection, it's done via that guest-to-host communication level using the VirtioFS tools. This has been available to set up in Proxmox if you want to do more advanced configurations with custom QEMU, KVU commands and configurations, but now they've actually added it to the GUI within the Proxmox web interface, making it a lot easier to set up for someone who's not super familiar with diving into the interface and adding custom options. In order to set up VirtioFS within the web interface, you have to first set up the path you want to share on the host, and then you have to add that path to the VMs that you want to have access to the path. So in my data center view, if I scroll down, I can now see this directory mappings. This is going to be for VirtioFS, and I can go under add, I can give it a name, so maybe like something like test VirtioFS, for example. I can give it which nodes I want to use it on, and then I can give it slash some path on my host, for example. And then I can go create it, and it's going to do it. So this is just a dummy one, but I've already created one already, so I can see my SSD share, which is on my white NAS, that's just the host name for the system. And then it's going to be the slash MNT slash SSD share slash path. Now that I've added it, I can see this SSD share path when I go to map it in a VM. So for example, if I take this VM that I'm going to set up for this video, I can go under add VirtioFS, select the mapping ID, in this case SSD share, and then that's it, unless I want to click advanced and view more options. And all the options seem to be either involving caching and how it should set up caching for this mount, and if you want to enable extended attributes or direct IO for that mount. So let's go add on this VM, and now the VirtioFS is available to be used by the VM. But like adding a raw disk, it isn't actually used until you configure it or set it up, which is going to be a little bit different depending on if your VM is running Linux or Windows. Let's go show a demo of how to set it up on both OSs. So for my Windows test, I'm going to be using a fully up-to-date version of Windows 11. But it should be similar if you're using Windows 10 or older versions, as well as Windows Server. Now that I'm on my desktop in my Windows 11 VM, let's go over setting up that VirtioFS share to be usable within Windows 11. So inside Windows, I'm going to actually have to install two pieces of software to access this share. The first piece of software I have to install comes with the main VirtioFS guest tools, comes with the main VirtIO guest tools that I suggest you always install. So if I put in my VirtIO ISO drive, I install this VirtIO win guest tools, and it automatically installs that part of the driver. If I take a look at my system by going under device manager, and then I go under system devices, I can see this VirtioFS drive. That means it's ready to access the data. If this is set up here, it should be ready to go when it comes to VirtioFS drivers. If you want to manually see and work with it, the actual driver itself is in this VirtioFS folder, and then your Windows version, and then your CPU architecture. And this program itself can mount the share if you want, but there's an easier auto way I'll go over in a second. And these are the Windows system files needed to make it work. In addition to installing this, you also have to install WinFSP, which is a little utility that allows Windows to work with fuse file system directories. If I Google WinFSP, it should be the top option, and then I can go under download, download WinFSP installer, and then I can go install this just following the default core installation and just pressing next a lot of times. I've actually already installed it on this system, so I can just say core, for example. I can just hit install, next, say yes to admin permissions, and then it should be ready to go. Once that is set up on my system, I'm going to go under services within Windows. The easiest way I find is go under run and then type in services.msc. I should open it and view all the services on my system. I'm going to just type in VI to get to the VirtioFS service. And then if I want to make it mounted and work right now, I can just hit start and it'll manually start the system. So under this PC, I can now see my SSD share, for example. And if I want to copy a file to it, I can go under like copy this WinFSP file and boom, it's copied without its properties. Permissions are a little bit interesting. I'm going to go over that in a minute. And then if I want to have it automatically start, I can go under properties here. I can say startup time automatic, and when set to automatic, it works fine and automatically mounts during system boot up. So if I go restart the system, for example, when it logs back in, it'll become auto-mounted and I don't have to do any additional steps from here on out to use that share. And if I add more shares, for example, they should just automatically come available to the system according to the settings I make to this Proxmox VM. And now that it's finished rebooting, I can just go in here and boom, see my share is accessible. When it comes to Linux, all the tools I need to access it should be already installed in most major Linux distros I looked at. But I have to still manually mount the VirtioFS and pick where I want to mount it on the system. So for example, I just have a little Debian system set up, which is just a blank Debian install. And then I'm just gonna log into this Debian system. For example, I have my SSD share set up. So then I can do sudo mount-t VirtioFS, and then the name of that share. So just this name right here. So SSD share, and then the path that I want to mount it in. I need to make that folder first, but I'm just gonna do /mmt. Once I type in my password, I can go into df-h and see that SSD share is mounted at /mmt. If I wanna make it mount permanently, I can use fstab for this. So I'd go sudo nano /etc/fstab. And then when I'm editing fstab, I'm gonna put that name, so SSD share in my example, the path that I want to mount it to, the file system, so in this case, VirtioFS, defaults when it comes to options, and then 0 space 0 when it comes to the amount of dump and pass. I can run sudo mount-a to apply my fstab mount immediately, so it's gonna just mount that VirtioFS right now. And if I run sudo reboot, it'll reboot my system and then automatically mount this path on boot up. And taking a look at my system after it rebooted, I can see it's mounted right at boot up without any additional action needed. Now I want to take a look at how VirtioFS compares to other ways of sharing a file share between your host OS like Proxmox and multiple different guest OSs. The main way that I've personally been setting this up on my home servers is mostly by using SMB or Samba shares, or sometimes NFS or network file system shares. These work over the internal network connection within your Proxmox system, but the other nice thing is they can also be mounted on another system that isn't within your Proxmox system. And there should be lots of guides out there to use them, but I really was curious, how do they compare to VirtioFS when it comes to speed, permissions, usability, and more? So when it comes to speed, what I did is I took my little Linux VM here, and I ran a variety of FIO tests on the VirtioFS share, the Samba share of the exact same drive, and running a block device on that same drive. The drive I was using in question was a Optane 900P, which should be nearly as fast as it gets for SSDs these days. And then I was using a Ryzen 7945HX system, which is also a pretty fast CPU. So this is probably near best case results. When it comes to doing random IO, I was getting about 60 megabytes per second on my VirtioFS share in Debian. It's going to be about 40 megabytes per second with just a default Samba configuration on the internal networking within that system. And then about 116, 117 megabytes per second on the block device, which is using a QCal2 block device on that same SSD. I also took a look at the CPU usage within the guest to see if there was anything weird going on when it comes to usage. And it did seem like there was more overhead when using Samba or VirtioFS compared to running that direct block device. And it was probably using about double, maybe triple the CPU usage. But this is kind of a worst case scenario here with a random read write of QDepth 1. And I was getting still well over 10,000 IOPS, which puts it on par with most of the kind of mid-range SSDs. When it comes to how I typically use these shares, I don't need the best performance. So I don't think this is bad by any means and not gonna stop me from using the shares. Typically, I'm going to be more interested when it comes to the sequential speeds and how fast I can copy large files. So over 2 gigs a second with VirtIO, 1.7 gigabytes per second with Samba, and about 2.4 gigabytes per second using the block device, all of which is pretty darn fast, and I'm not going to be waiting very much at all for that drive to do most tasks I would be. And typically, I think of these shared drives as copying files around, and in most cases, I'm not going to be limited, it looks like, by the actual protocols used. Now, the other question I had is, what about Windows? So I set up Crystal Disk Mark on Windows, and the performance numbers for random I/O numbers looks fine. But the issue is it's running right now, and this is happening. It's not responsive. It seems like it's freezing up the system or something. And taking a look at the usage on my host, it's pinning one core at 100%. So it seems like something's single thread limited, and it's also making it so the UI is almost unusable. Here's the Crystal Disk Mark numbers when it actually finishes, which is fine for random I/O and actually close to what I got in Linux, but sequential I/O is pretty bad. Now, one thought I had is Crystal Disk Mark sometimes acts odd and maybe something weird's going on. So I made a 10 gigabyte test file that I'm just gonna copy and paste within this VirtIO share to see how fast it copies. And yeah, that's roughly the same performance I was getting with Crystal Disk Mark. There seems to be something slow about the implementation of VirtIOFS within Windows that causes, at least when you're pushing it really hard with Crystal Disk Mark, to freeze up and having, I'd say, excessive CPU usage. So yeah, look at VirtIOFS using like 14% of the CPU. And if I also take a look at my host, I see some processes that are pretty close to 100%, which makes me think it's single thread limited. This does not seem to be an optimal implementation to me. And just for a quick test, here's the SMB file share within Windows, copying and pasting a file, and it's going at about 1.9 gigabytes per second. In summary, using this on Linux, performance seems to be pretty good when it comes to sharing it between files, so I wouldn't pick between VirtIOFS and a Samba share on performance alone. And typically, I'd be using this to like copy larger files around or things like that, where not having the most I/O isn't the end of the world, and I'm likely using hard drives or slow SSDs under the hood anyways, where the additional overhead probably won't matter. But what does matter quite a bit more to me is the usability and how easy it is to use and how many features I get. One thing I really like about that mount mapping within LXC containers is I don't have to configure anything else in the guest. That mount point is just mounted and ready to go and access the files. The disadvantage with this is I still have to mount it like any other file system would. So my thoughts is I could just mount an SMB share there and it's mounted and ready to go. So it's not really saving any steps like I would with LXC. Now, I guess setting up an SMB server can be a bit more complicated than setting up this shared space within Proxmox, as I do have to dive into the interface on something and set up Samba, and Samba definitely can be a little bit of a pain to set up if you haven't worked with Samba before. But at least for me, who does have some experience, I don't see that as a selling feature. The other kind of disadvantage I see with this implementation is there doesn't seem to be any way to set up or work with permissions very much. One thing I was hoping that I'd see in this implementation that I did see in Virt Manager in the past when working with it is a read-only option. So perhaps I could fill it with like installer files or ISO images or other files that VMs might need to access, but I can't have it modified in case something weird happens or a user wants to mess with something. Could be a nice way of exposing a lot of files to a user that might be helpful without having to have duplicated copies, for example. But that isn't available, and all I can do is set up extended attributes and POSIX permissions. I was actually playing with these POSIX permissions a little bit, and it doesn't look like there's any way to like limit VMs or permissions and how it works between it, and I can go change permissions on the guest to give me write access. So while I could limit a lower level user within a VM from accessing those files, I couldn't limit a VM from accessing files on the host. Maybe I'm doing something wrong with permissions and not accessing it right, and maybe there's ways to do it diving into the command line, but I feel like having at least a read-only option would be awesome or make the permission options a little bit more visible. When it comes to Samba, you can go to town when it comes to permissions and easily set up like read-only for specific users or make a lot of folder and file level permissions within a Samba share. Now, certainly that can get complicated, but I'd rather have permissions that can get complicated than not having the option at all. After playing with and using VirtioFS a little bit within Proxmox, I'm glad they added the option. Kimio KVM has a lot of options available to it for a lot of different workloads, so it's nice that Proxmox is adding them to the GUI, so if a user wants it for some reason, it's easy to do it within their GUI and interface instead of having to add custom Kimio KVM options to your VM's config. But for my personal use case, I don't think I'm going to be switching over from Samba as my main way of mounting my main file share within my Linux and Windows VMs. I think generally Samba is about as easy to set up as VirtioFS setup because I still have to modify something like fstab so it mounts automatically at boot. It's not like LXC map mount points where it's just an instant, don't have to think about it, it's mounted configuration. The other thing is VirtioFS has problems on Windows from what I can tell. Performance is much worse and it sometimes seems to almost lock up the VM and have single threaded limits. Because of this, I'd say this is an almost non-starter on Windows if you need anything remotely performance sensitive. The other thing is, I have lots of physical systems I want to be able to access that same file share, and VirtioFS doesn't work for those, so I'm still going to have to maintain a Samba server anyways so that systems on my network can access that same share. Now, I'm curious what you think about VirtioFS. Have you already implemented it via adding custom options to Proxmox? Are you going to try it out now that it's in here? Does this sound like something interesting to you? Looking forward to hearing what your thoughts on this is in the comments below. And let me know if you have the same issues with Windows and performance of VirtioFS. I'd love to know if it's some weird configuration I have or if it's a just general issue that VirtioFS and Windows has. It does seem from what I've seen with a lot of the other VirtIO tools, they definitely design it with Linux as the primary guest and then add support for Windows so you can use Windows as well, which is great that they have support for it, but the Windows implementation does not seem to perform as well as the Linux implementation.